Welcome back to Unshakable, friends. Thanks for joining me once again. I know it's been a hot minute since we last talked. And I know that's not because there's been a lack of things to talk about. It's just because ministry life for me has become very, very full in the last couple of months. And so I haven't been able to sit down and record any new episodes. So I am really glad to be with you today. Glad that, first of all, we were able to finish our series on the war in Israel. If you missed any of those, go back and take a listen, because I think it's important for Christians today to be aware of what's going on in the Middle East and around the world. But glad today to get back to something more practical, to get back to this church culture series and some really practical instruction about life in the body of Christ. And today's topic couldn't be more practical. We're talking about a very important part of ecclesiology, which is the doctrine of the church. And specifically, we're talking about something called church polity. I'm not sure if you've heard that word before, church polity, which is all about this question: how should a local church be structured and governed? Now, most people don't fully realize this, but if a church isn't organized or structured correctly, as the Bible tells us, then how can you expect it to function as the Bible describes? It simply won't. If it's not organized correctly, it's not going to function right. So ecclesiology and church polity really, really matter, more so than the average churchgoer understands. In fact, listen, anytime you begin to search for a new church home, let's say you move to a new area, this should be very near the top of your list of questions to ask about any church that you're considering. You want to ask somebody, tell me how your church is organized or structured. How is it governed? And which of these two things guide you in that? Is it pragmatism or is it scripture? Very, very important. So today we're looking at a specific aspect of church polity, the office and role of a deacon in the church. And in particular, we're asking this question: is deacon an office and a role for men only, or is it an office and a role that could or even should be fulfilled by faithful women in the church? Now, this is a hotly debated issue in pastoral circles today, trust me. We'll see why in just a moment when we look at the key text that informs us on this subject. But it's been made even hotter in our day by two opposing forces, both of which I think are in error. On the one side, there are many churches today that are giving into the spirit of the age. They are allowing egalitarianism to seep into their church polity. What do I mean by that? Simply that they're allowing women to hold offices in their church that are reserved for men only according to the Bible, the offices of pastor, teacher, and elder. Now, why do they do this? Well, mostly because they don't want to take a hard stand on a tough subject like this. Even if they see it in black and white in the Bible, because it's there, they would rather sort of dance around that clear teaching and then try to come up with some kind of spin on it, a new alternative interpretation, all so that they can grow their churches and remain popular with the culture and appear relevant to the age. Friends, these are churches you must avoid. But then on the other side of the fence, there are good, strong, faithful churches that are reacting to that unbiblical egalitarian trend by swinging the pendulum so hard in the other direction that they're not allowing women to serve in roles where I believe they can serve and should be serving. And in doing that, and I've seen this before in conservative Bible-teaching churches, oftentimes women feel squashed by the male headship in those churches. They feel almost relegated to second-class status. And so, like so many other things in the church today, we have a hard time finding a healthy balance when we come to issues that sort of live in the gray. But I don't think it has to be this way. I really don't. I'm convinced that we can find the line that Scripture draws on gender roles in the church, and we can hold to those lines without overcompensating and ending up erring on the other side of the debate. Now, the fact of the matter is, strong, solid churches do disagree on the issue of deacons. Let me break it down for you. I'll divide the disagreements into three categories. Number one, some churches, again, solid churches, won't allow for deaconesses because they're not convinced by Scripture that it's a legitimate office for a woman to hold. And that's fine. That's a good reason and a good conviction. Even though I disagree with that, if that's your reason, then that's a good conviction. But number two, some churches, again, solid churches, won't allow for deaconesses because in their way of thinking, it could open the door to the advance of feminism and egalitarianism in their church. That's not a good reason. That is not a good reason. Well, if we did this, it could open the door to something worse down the line. That's not a good reason. In fact, that's what the Pharisees did in Jesus' day, and he rebuked them for it. The Pharisees added regulations to God's law under the banner of, well, look, we're helping people not to get too close to falling into sin. But in reality, according to Jesus, they were laying down man-made boundaries that God didn't instruct them to lay down. And that's sin. And it's confusing to people, too. When people are told, women can't be deacons because we're worried about where that might lead, that's confusing. That's confusing God's commands with man's worry. And it's not an acceptable answer. We're not called to draw lines out of fear. We draw lines based on what the Bible says, and then we hold to those lines. Now, the third group of churches, and we would include Oak Hill in this third group. First of all, we're not out to please the culture or to be popular or to fit into the spirit of the age. We are convinced by Scripture that it's not only allowable, but profitable for the church body for women to serve in the role of deaconess. Now, why? Well, let's look at the evidence on this. Let's walk through sort of a logical progression of why we come to that place. Starting with the word itself, what is a deacon? Well, in the Greek New Testament, a deacon is known as a diakonos. It's a word that is rooted in a verb that describes its function, the verb diakoneo. And it means to serve or to minister. So very simple, serve or minister. So that's what a deacon is called to do. He or she serves or ministers. I know that's a pretty broad description, so we're going to have to come back and define that just a bit more. But the word, so in some places in the New Testament, diakoneo is used in connection with very simple tasks like, waiting on tables and serving food. But in other places, it's used in a very serious way. For example, speaking of how Paul, who's an apostle, ministered to the churches in the first century. So it has some simple application, but also some serious ministry-related application. By the way, it's also the same word that Jesus used when he said, "Whoever desires to become great among you shall be your servant, your diakonos." Same word. Now, there are two key places in the New Testament where diakonos is mentioned as more than just something that a Christian does. It's described as either a formal role in the church or a formal office in the church. Let me give you those two places. The first one is in Philippians 1:1, where Paul is addressing his letter to the church in Philippi. And here's what he writes. He says, "To all the saints who are in Philippi, including," listen now, "the overseers and the deacons." So by mentioning those two side by side, that is a clear indication that Paul in the first century recognized two very clear, distinct offices in the church, overseers and deacons. Okay, so that seems like a formal declaration that a deacon is an office within the church at Philippi. Now, the second place we need to look at is our key text for this episode. So if you don't have a Bible, you should grab one because we're going to get a little bit technical here and it'll help. So you can put pause here, you can press pause and go get your Bible and come back. But we're going to 1 Timothy 3, verses 8 through 12. 1 Timothy 3. 8 through 12. Here we go. Hopefully you got your Bible open. Verse 8, "Deacons, likewise," now I'm reading from the New American Standard here. It's easy to read right past that word "likewise," but take note of that word. It's important. We'll come back to it. "Deacons, likewise, must be men of dignity." So that's obvious that we're talking about male deacons now, men of dignity, "not double-tongued or addicted to much wine or fond of sordid gain, but holding to the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience." Verse 10, "these men," very clear, we're talking about men, "these men must also first be tested, then let them serve as deacons if they are beyond reproach." Okay, deep breath. Here comes the key verse now. Verse 11 starts out, women, now the Greek root of that word is gune, which can be translated either women or wives. But as I just read in the New American Standard, it reads women. In other translations, it looks different. In the CSB, it renders it wives. And then in the ESV, It also says wives, but it adds a possessive pronoun. The ESV says their wives. So we have a controversy here, right? And you can see, I mean, again, same word in the Greek, but you've got three translations that render it differently. And that, by the way, highlights something in Bible translations, how every translation committee has to make some interpretive decisions when it translates. But we'll come back to that in a moment. First, let's keep going. In the NAS, it says, women must likewise, note the second use of the word likewise, women must likewise be dignified, not malicious gossips, but temperate, faithful in all things. And then we're going to see Paul come back to male deacons again in verse 12. Verse 12, deacons must be husbands of only one wife. So there it is, very clear. This is men, and good managers of their children and their own households. Okay, so we got to figure it out. What does the word mean in verse 11? Does it mean women? Does it mean wives? Does it mean their wives? And by their wives, that would mean the wives of the deacons described in verse 10. So what I want to do as we work to look through this, sort through this, is to talk about two things, the prescriptive data on this subject and then the descriptive data on it. Prescriptive means what does the Bible prescribe? What does it intentionally teach about deacons? And then descriptive refers to places in the Bible where deacons are mentioned in the narrative. So it's important to look at that as well. But let's start with the prescriptive. As we've seen, the Greek word in verse 11 can be translated women or wives or their wives, meaning the wives of the male deacons. So what did Paul intend? This is what we call authorial intent. What did Paul intend to communicate here? Was he referring to the deacons' wives or to women in general who serve as deaconesses? That is the core question. So let me give you the argument for the position that I do not take, that gune in verse 11 refers to the wives of the male deacons. Here are the main two arguments for that. Argument number one goes like this, that it seems awkward that Paul would put the requirements for deaconesses in the middle of talking about male deacons, which he does. In verse 10, he's talking about men. In verse 12, he's talking about men. So then why not wait until you finish talking about male deacons and then after that lay out the requirements for female deaconesses? It just seems awkward. Why break into the middle of 10 and 12 and give us 11 and talk about women? That's the first argument. Second one is this, that the same word, gune, is used in verse 12, and there it clearly means wife. So consistency would tell us that we should interpret that word in verse 11 as wife. Okay, so those aren't bad arguments. I know interpreters, theologians, pastors that hold to that position, and they're not bad arguments. But are they enough to win the day? Let me give you the argument for the position I take, that gune in verse 11 refers to women, not wives. I'll share three reasons why I think it means women in general. First, go back to that word likewise. Notice it's found in both verse 8 and verse 11. That's important. The word in the Greek New Testament, hosatos, it means in the same way or in the same manner. And using that word here sounds like it's introducing a new office. When you see that word likewise, it sounds throughout this text like it's introducing a new office. Why do I say that? Because Paul uses that word in verse 8 to distinguish between one office or one category of men, which are elders. Okay, he talks about elders in verses 1 through 7. And then he comes to verse 8, and he comes to a new and distinct category of people, of men, deacons. And he uses this word likewise. He says, first of all, here are the qualifications for elder, verses 1 through 7. Now, likewise, here are the qualifications for deacons. And he switches to a new office, and he starts with male deacons. But then in verse 11, he once again says, likewise, women, or women likewise. And so it seems that once again, he's transitioning from one category of people, male deacons, to a new and distinct category of people, female deacons. That's the way I read it. Now, you might object, well, okay, maybe he's transitioning to a new category, but that category is wives of male deacons. Here's the problem with that, and this is my reason number two why I think that's not true. In the original Greek text, there is no possessive pronoun connecting gune to the male deacons. In other words, it doesn't say their wives or their women, it just says women or wives. If Paul had intended to connect that word in verse 11 with the male deacons in verse 10, it would say their wives. There would be a possessive pronoun there, but it's not there. It's not there. By the way, that tells me that by adding the word there, that the ESV really engaged in heavy interpretive work in that spot. In my opinion, they engaged in egregious interpretive work there, because that possessive pronoun is not in the Greek text. They added it as an interpretive tool. Last reason. I think this is the strongest of all three. If Paul intended to lay out clear and serious qualifications for the wives of deacons here, then there's something missing in verses 1 through 7. Did you catch it? Let me say it again. If verse 11 doesn't refer to women in general, but it refers to the wives of the deacons, again, the personal pronoun, the possessive pronoun is not there, but let's just go with the argument that it refers to the wives of the deacons in verse 10, there's something missing above in verses 1 through 7. There are no qualifications for elder wives. There's only qualifications for deacons' wives. That makes no sense, because the elder position is the loftier position. The elder position is the position with authority. Deacons are the lesser of the two offices. Deacons are the office with less authority and fewer qualifications overall. So ask yourself, why would there be qualifications for deacons' wives and not for elders' wives? That makes no sense at all. And so that leads me to believe that gune in verse 11 should be translated women in general and not wives. Okay. So I don't know if you caught all that. I hope so. But that's the technical exegetical debate that's been going on for a long time. Let's move from prescriptive to descriptive. This is an important question. Are women actually described in the New Testament serving as deacons? Well, here it's interesting. People on both sides of the debate agree that women throughout the Bible are in fact described as carrying out deacon-type ministry. Everybody agrees with that. They're essential servants and ministers in a whole bunch of ways. The only question really is are they, when they do that, are they functioning within an official office of the church? Okay. So the closest example that we have, if you want to look for, okay, here's a woman who's doing a lot of valuable ministry and she seems to function within a formal office, you have Phoebe in Romans 16. She's probably the best example. Now, if you know Romans 16, this is Paul's, you know, closing to this massive letter that he's written to the Roman church, and he includes a long list of both men and women whom he's really thankful for. But who is at the top of that list? And that mattered back in the ancient world. Who's number one on the list? Who does he mention first? It's this woman named Phoebe. And Paul seems to emphasize her value in the church above everybody else on the list. He writes the most about her and starts with her. Here's what he says. I commend to you our sister Phoebe, who is a servant of the church, which is at Cenchrea. What's the word there for servant? Diakonos. She is a deacon of the church at Cenchrea. That you receive her in the Lord, he goes on, in a manner worthy of the saints, and that you help her in whatever matter she may have need of you, for she herself has also been a helper of many and of myself as well. Now, again, does that imply that Phoebe had an official position or office within the church? Maybe, maybe not. The debate rages on, but there is no doubt that she was a unique and highly valuable and qualified woman in the ministry of Paul. Very important. Now, what about church history? What can we learn from how the church over the centuries has interpreted and practiced this? Well, I won't spend a ton of time on this because, as we know, church history, while it is very instructive and always helpful, it is not infallible. What church history does is provide some guardrails to look at so that we can make sure that we're not outside the bounds of what previous saints have believed and practiced. But of course, not all saints through the generations are going to agree, but it's helpful to see who has believed what and who has practiced what. So it's good to look at. So let me give you just a handful of important anecdotes from church history. First of all, in a very interesting and important letter from an ancient Roman governor by the name of Pliny the Younger, he wrote to the Roman Emperor Trajan, and we have his letter, which is so interesting. It's dated very early, very close to the death of the Apostle John. Probably somewhere around the year 112. That's very old. And in this letter, Pliny is inquiring of the emperor on how he should deal with these frustrating people he calls Christians. And in his letter, he describes how he interrogated two women, and he refers to them as ministre, which is the Latin equivalent of diakonos. This is a fascinating historical tidbit, because Pliny seems to understand that these women hold some official function or office within this place that they call the church. Okay, so, and that's, again, very old. So it seems to me the deaconesses were present at the time of this period where the church is being handed off from the apostles to the earliest church fathers. That's very, very important. In the late second century, Clement of Alexandria, one of the earliest and most prominent of the church fathers, he wrote on this text in 1 Timothy 3, and he presented evidence for the existence of what he called, quote, women deacons. So he believed it was true. Not long after that, in the early third century, we have a document called the Teaching of the Apostles, which was a manual, an ancient church order manual, and in it you read of deaconesses who did two things in particular. Number one, they served the poor, and number two, they instructed other women who were candidates for baptism. Very interesting. Again, not infallible, but we can see here that in the early third century, deaconesses were active in the church. In the fourth century, the great preacher of Constantinople, John Chrysostom, described the order of deaconesses to be, quote, necessary and useful and honorable in the church. Very important. Also in the fourth century, archaeologists have uncovered tomb inscriptions that show evidence that female deacons served in the early church. There's one really important inscription that's found right near the Mount of Olives in Jerusalem, and it describes a woman named Sophia. Here's what the inscription reads. It says, "Here lives the slave and the bride of Christ, Sophia, the deacon, the second Phoebe." That is so interesting. Sophia, the deacon, the second Phoebe. A man named Theodoret, who was a 5th century bishop in Antioch, an excellent thinker. In his writings, he refers to Phoebe as a woman deacon and commends her as an example for the church in his day. And then finally, at the very important Council of Chalcedon in 451, the process for ordination of deaconesses is expressly described in the record of the council. So this was a common practice in the early church. Now, if we fast forward then through the Dark Ages and the Roman Catholic Church and all that to the time of the Reformation, there's even more evidence for the work of deaconesses in the church. First of all, think about this. The Protestant doctrine of the priesthood of all believers had a definite impact on church polity. Not just male servants, but women too were seen as part of that priesthood of all believers, all of us called to function in ways that would build up the body of Christ. And even leaders like John Calvin. Calvin echoed the early church's approval of deaconesses. He saw their work as essential to the church's function. Especially, Calvin saw deaconesses important related to overseeing mercy ministry. And that's something we see consistent throughout church history, that women were often called to that work, serving the poor, mercy ministry, things of that nature. Now today, listen, there are many prominent conservative pastors and theologians who hold the same view that we do at Oak Hill, that women can and should serve as deacons. That list includes none other than John MacArthur and John Piper and Mark Dever and a couple really good theologians who I love to read, Tom Schreiner, Douglas Moo, men of that nature. A lot of guys really do agree with our position. So we're not out of the ordinary here at all. Now, let me close with this, because I know this is going on for quite a while here. In light of the controversy and the arguments on both sides from good solid theologians, what is it that ultimately determines the answer for us at Oak Hill? Why have we chosen then to say, okay, we are going to affirm deaconesses? Again, I think the text of Scripture is clear enough to sway us in that direction, and I believe the evidence from the Bible and from church history is a good supplement to that. But ultimately, even if I believe the biblical arguments on both sides were just completely equal, 50-50, and it could go either way, what is it that pushes me towards my position of deaconesses? Here it is. Are you ready? It's the role of deacons itself. The role of deacons itself is what pushes me to my position. Why? Well, remember, what does a deacon call to do? It is a high service role. So in a biblical polity situation where there are two offices, elders and deacons, the deacons don't possess ruling authority. Deacons don't possess teaching authority. Deacons are about service. It's a high service role. And there is no biblical precedent for prohibiting women from any service role in the body. Women are prohibited from ruling authority and teaching authority, but there is no biblical precedent for prohibiting women from a service role in the body. Therefore, establishing deaconesses does not undermine male headship or male authority in the church. So why would you want to disallow it? Why would you want to disallow it? Why would you not let a woman serve as a deaconess? I'll go a step further. Why would you not want a woman to serve as an usher or a greeter? There's all kinds of places where they don't carry teaching authority or ruling authority. They're just high service roles. Why would you want to disallow that? Again, if a church does so out of fear of the slippery slope, fear of cracking the door open to egalitarianism, that is not a good justification for prohibiting women from serving as God wired them and as they're allowed to do in Scripture. And listen, guys, at Oak Hill, we want women to flourish in ministry and service. We want them to be able to serve in every way that the Bible allows. And I am convinced after many, many years in ministry that the ministry of women in the church is essential to a healthy church body. Because, newsflash, not all things are done best by men. We need faithful ladies to come alongside the elders of the church in ministry and service. Again, not authority, not ruling authority, not teaching authority, but to come alongside the elders to minister and to serve. So we're not going to be one of those churches that fails to employ the giftedness of women to their fullest biblical extent out of fear or what other people might think. We are going to stick to the lines that Scripture gives us. Okay. I don't know if that convinced you or not. So here's what I want to say. First of all, thanks for joining me today. But if you have any questions or you want to push back on my argument, you want to give me another argument why I'm either right or wrong, don't hesitate to comment below or shoot me a message. I would love to engage with you on that. Again, friends, thanks for joining me on this. I hope this was helpful and practical. Until next time, remain unshakable and love each other well.